HarperCollins presents Boy Giant, Son of Gulliver by Michael Morpurgo. Read by Akbar Kurtha.
For Tom and Kate, and for Hannah, Jack and Zoe, M.M. To my big brothers, Ivan and Pud, giants of my boyhood, M.F. With thanks to Jonathan Swift, author of The Great Gulliver's Travels, published on the 28th of October, 1726. Thanks also to Claire, Michael Foreman, Vicky Berwick, Nick Lake and Anne Janine Murtaugh for their help in making this book happen. And also my thanks to Sarah Outen, ocean rower extraordinaire and an inspiration to us all. Be not inhospitable to strangers, lest they be angels in disguise. George Whitman. First part. Chapter 1. Tiny, they called me. All we knew about her was that she called herself JJ and that she spoke English, that she was alone out there in the big yellow rowing boat, and that she was like a giant to all three of us, even me, a giant with a bandaged wrist and plasters on her fingers. "So tell me," she said. "Tell me everything." I could hardly refuse, could I? I mean, this JJ had saved our lives. It was thanks only to the stranger that we were dry again, well-fed, warm and rested. "I mean," she went on, "I want to know how it is that you're out here, on the open ocean, in such a small boat. Who are you? Where have you come from?" I could have asked her much the same questions, but I found myself telling her our whole story. I was happy to tell her too, not just because she had shown us such kindness, but because once I began telling her our story out loud, it somehow helped me to believe it had all really happened to me. Helped me to remember who I was, who I had become. That she would believe me, I had no doubt. After all, she had the evidence right in front of her. She could hardly take her eyes off the evidence. The three of us were there to prove it. We were the truth of our own story. I began at the beginning, because without the beginning, none of it would have made sense to her. And anyway, none of it would have ever happened. I would never have had to leave home, and my life would have been another story altogether. "It's quite a long story," I told her. "That's fine," she said. "I need to rest this wrist anyway. Can't row far like this." So I began. Where I come from is no longer my home. There was a house and a village I once called my home in Afghanistan. I had a family of my own once. Not anymore. I have my name, Omar, and I have my mother. But I don't know where she is. I think and I hope she may be in England with Uncle Saeed. I was on my way to find her. That's why we were out here on our little boat when you found us and we found you. I don't know anymore what day or month or year it is, but I think I must be 16 years old. Of my beginnings, of my home, there is not much to tell. And I do not like to speak of it or think of it, because it makes me sad to remember. My home was a quiet place in a peaceful town in the countryside. We lived on the edge of town. My father was a shepherd. Our flock was our livelihood. We never went hungry or thirsty. I had a little sister, Hanan. She and I were much loved in our home. We were together. We were all happy. School was school. All my friends were there. We learnt our lessons, played together. But I was always small and thin, and at school I was never allowed to forget it. Diney, they called me. Little I may have been, but I was by far the best at cricket. No one hit the ball harder. No one bowled faster. The pitch was always bumpy, but it was the same for all of us, and it was fine. Everything was fine. I could read the bounce of every ball they bowled at me, see it onto the bat. I lived for cricket and my family. Everything was good. Well, mostly. Every night I went to sleep wishing I would score more runs the next day or take more wickets. And I prayed I would be a little taller in the morning. I would measure myself against the mark Mother had made on the wall. The next day, I would often score more runs, or take more wickets, or both. But I was never any taller. Hanan was still taller than me every morning, and she was 2 years younger than me. Then the war came to our town, and I had other worries, more serious worries. I do not know to this day why the war came. It was on the morning of my 10th birthday, I remember. We heard the planes in the sky, and then the bombing began. We were in school. There was nowhere to hide, nowhere to run to. At the end of that day, our home was in ruins. Our school, too. Many of my friends had died. I was there when they were buried. I helped to bury them. Father died, too, when the planes came again the next morning. And so did most of our sheep. Then we discovered Hanan was missing. We looked and we called, but we never found her. Only Mother and I were left. We had nothing. No shelter, no food, no father, no sister, no daughter. The aid workers came after that, and they bought us food and tents and built us a refugee camp. We weren't a family anymore. We were refugees. We lived in that camp a long time. The aid workers were from England, and they were very kind to us. They smiled at us, and we liked that. It cheered our hearts. There were doctors and nurses who were good to us. It was cold through that winter, but we survived. The refugee camp was never a home for us. It was a place of shelter, that's all. Sometimes we played football and cricket with the aid workers, and they taught me to speak a little English. They were amazed at how good I was at cricket. I liked to amaze them. It made them smile. But then one day Mother said it was not safe for us to stay, and that she was sure the planes would come again, or the soldiers. Many in the camp had decided to leave, and we would go with them. So Mother and I, and a few others, we left the camp in the middle of the night and began to walk. We walked for weeks and weeks. We walked over the mountains, through the desert, followed where the others went, all of us, with only one thing on our minds, to find somewhere far away from the war, anywhere that was a place of peace, where there was food and water and shelter, where we could be safe. How long and how far we walked, I do not know. Sleep was our only comfort. You can forget when you are asleep. Waking up was the worst part of every day. I wanted only to stay where I was, curled up on the ground and never get up again. I was so tired, too tired to care anymore. Mother saved my life every morning. She would never let me lie there. She always said that if I didn't get up and walk on, I would die. And she wasn't going to let that happen. She would tell me sometimes that she could smell the sea, and that I had to be strong and brave like Father and Hanan had been. She promised me that beside the sea there would be a boat waiting for us, to carry us to safety, to a new life, in a new home, where there would be lots of smiling people like the aid workers and doctors and nurses in the camp, and where there would be no more war and no bombing. All I had to do, Mother said, was put one foot in front of the other. Her love and her promises were all that kept me walking. There were wire fences, there were lorries, there were trains, there were more refugee camps. The police beat us. There were people who yelled at us to go home, others who took us in and fed us and gave us warm clothes and smiled at us. We never knew what to expect. But Mother and me, we put one foot in front of the other. And we walked. Chapter 2. 4 Street, Mevagissi. Sure enough, after a year or more of wandering, one day we came over a hill, and there, just as Mother had promised, was the sea, and some houses and people, and like a miracle, there was a boat waiting for us. Mother told me, her arm around me, that God was good to us, and that I should always believe that. She had little enough to sell, the bracelets on her arms, the rings on her fingers. They were enough to pay the men to allow me onto their boat, but not Mother. None of her tears nor mine were enough to persuade them to let her go with me. I had to go alone, she told me. She would follow on later. We would find one another in England, she promised me faithfully. And mother always keeps her promises. I remember her last words to me. Go to your Uncle Saeed in his cafe in Mevagisi, she told me. 4th Street, Mevagisi. Remember, 4th Street. Remember, Mevagisi. Say it over and over in your head, Omar, so that you do not ever forget. 4th Street, Mevagisi. 4th Street, Mevagisi. Wait for me there. I will come. Go now, Omar. Say to the people in England that you are his nephew, and they will let you stay. Uncle Saeed told me they will do this. Tell them where he lives, where he works in his cafe. They will let you stay with him. Do not worry. They will have smiling eyes, and there is no war there either. This way you will live, and if you live, so will I. We will meet again. We will, God willing. I clung to her. I cried into her. She whispered in my ear that she loved me more than life itself. But I had to be a man now, like father had been, that I had to be brave like Hanan, that I was to go and cry no more. Smile for me, she said, so I will remember you this way. I tried so hard, but I did not succeed. My tears would not let me. The last time I saw mother, she was standing there on the shore watching the boat take me away. She was becoming smaller before my eyes. Soon she was not there at all. And then nor was the shore. I was in a big rubber boat with an engine that coughed and spluttered. The boat was so full of people that it was difficult for all of us to find anywhere to sit down. To begin with, the sea was calm about us, lapping but calm. People were telling one another that it wasn't far, that it was a good boat, that we would soon be there, soon be safe. I had seen the sea in photographs, on films, and it had always been blue. But this sea was not blue. It was grey and wide and darkening and threatening, and it seemed to go on forever into the distance where it became sky, a sky that was grey as the sea. I do not know how many nights and days I spent on that boat. I found at last a place to sit on the side. There I passed the long cold hours, trying all the while to calm my fears. I made myself imagine Mevagisi, the place where I was going. I tried to think of Uncle Saeed in his cafe in England. I had never met him. I had seen his photograph, the one mother had kept with her all the time. I had spoken to him once a long time ago before on Skype. But then he was pixelated, so I could not see him at all. I could tell that he had a moustache, and not much else. I remember his voice quite well, though. He told me I should come and see him one day, and help him in his cafe. I'm coming, Uncle Saeed, I shouted out loud. 4th Street, Mevagisi! 4th Street, Mevagisi! Some people around me on the boat looked at me as if I had gone mad, but I didn't mind what they thought. I was going to Mevagisi. 4th Street, Mevagisi.
Chapter 3. Something to Cling On To.
Mevagisi, 4th Street, Mevagisi. I kept saying these words out loud to myself on the boat, so I should never forget them, but also because I wanted to practice them. I practiced all the English words I knew that the aid workers had taught me. Hello, sun. Goal. Foul. Chocolate. High five. Manchester United. Chelsea. Goodbye. See you. Come back soon. And of course, all the cricket words I knew, like bowler, batsman, over, wicket, out, not out, 4, 6, and owsat. Owsat was my favourite word. It cheered me up every time I said it. I wanted to speak as many English words as I could before I arrived in England. I wanted to show off to mother, when I saw her, how well I could speak English. And practicing my English words kept my mind off the sea and the waves and the cold and the sound of all the moaning and crying around me in the boat. Hope kept me going too. I hoped everyone in England would be smiling as mother had said they would be. I hoped we would be happy there and safe. Just thinking about it made me happy. I would have a home again, and go to school, have friends again, play cricket again.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.